At T-Mobile, we're declaring the end of data limits. Introducing T-Mobile One. One price, all unlimited, for everyone. That's right. Get unlimited 4G LTE data on your smartphone on our network that was built to handle it. And get it at a price that won't break the bank. With four lines of unlimited LTE data for just $35 a line per month with AutoPay. Switch today.
Top 3% of data users greater than 26 gigabytes per month may see reduced speeds until next bill cycle. Video typically streams at 480p with qualifying credit discount via bill credit plus taxes and fees.
Welcome to the war room. We got Dez, Kim, Jimmy, PJ, B. Austin, the hot block commander.
Give it to you. How you want to end up 1 or 2 hour show to keep the brain running with the premise of talk sports on a national level. Roll with the topic, sort of like the rubber. When it's game time, they like the Fab Five during prime time. Sports conglomerates speak their minds a little bit. For sports medicine and sports veterans and greats. The 4 for 26, so the war in Kuwait. It's the war room with five nights at the round table. Five Philly guys, diversified and educated.
What up, War Room family? You are once again live in the War Room, brought to you by War Room Sports and the War Room Sports Podcast Network. I'm your boy, Devin McMillan, and I am piloting this thing solo, at least for the first half of the show. B. Austin should join us in a little while. But look, the playoff picture in the NFL is still a distant blur. We'll talk about one of the major players, that being the Dallas Cowboys, because they had a lot of things happen this week within that organization. So keep it locked right here for the next 2 hours. And if you want to holler at us throughout the show, just join the JW Philly Realty chat room right now. You can do that by going to blogtalkradio.com/the War Room, or you could join us on Facebook or Twitter at War Room Sports. You can also call in directly. When we open up the Digital Extreme Tech Hotline, that number is 323-410-0012. Quick reminder before we get started. Throughout the week, when we're not on the air, remember to check out our podcast network. Besides our own podcast, The War Room, on the War Room Sports Podcast Network, you can also listen to shows such as The Broad Street Line, Chris, The Tissue and the Tape Hip Hop Show with Phil Maddock and Savad, John Appetit with The Burtons, Quick Glance with Fred Perdue, and our latest gem for all you TV heads, On the Couch with the Wilsons. Just visit warlords.com, click on the WRS Podcast Network tab, or go to our free mobile app and click the network tab on the app. So look, everybody, man, this I'm just wondering if the Trump victory has set in with you guys out there yet, because their story after story. Every single day, and I'm talking, regular news, I'm talking sports news, but there's a lot going on here where I live in the Washington, D.C. area. You've had high school students staging walkouts due to the Trump being elected. I have a kindergartner, and they actually sent home a paper in his folder, and I'm sure it doesn't have anything to do with his particular school since it's an elementary school, but in the county, I presume they have to send this letter to everyone, and there's a planned walkout for Prince George's County, and that's in Maryland, students on Friday. So there's been a lot of protesting the election results. There's been a lot of dialogue back and forth. I hear a lot of people saying, well, what's it going to do? It's not going to do anything. It's a waste of time. I've heard people criticize students saying they're not even allowed to vote. So what are they protesting for? But I know the first school in my area that did it, it's a school in an area that has a lot of, immigrants. So I would presume that a lot of the parents of some of these students, might be affected by Trump's policies or at least Trump's words throughout this whole election season. So, it's good to see the kids standing for something, whether they can vote or not. It's good to see everybody stand for something and exercise their right to protest. So I don't see anything wrong with it. The only thing, And on a small level, pretty much every president has probably protested somewhere, but this might set a dangerous precedent. It might come to a point where every time somebody loses that's not your candidate, people are going to take to the streets and protest. But that's another story for another time. Let me get into a little bit of this sports talk here. So I'm going to let you guys know what happened this week while y'all were on the ground. And as usual, While You Are on the Grind is brought to you by DirecTV. If you like a better TV experience than cable has to offer, including that NFL Sunday ticket, go to our website, worldroomsports.com, click on the DirecTV logo, order yourself a better TV experience at a discounted World Room Sports sign-up rate. If you call yourself a sports fan, then you gotta have DirecTV. All right, Von Miller is in the news this week. All-pro defensive end slash linebacker for the world champion Denver Broncos. Von Miller is scrambling to block a sex tape, reportedly of him, that was filmed in Cancun. He said he's being extorted for millions of dollars. Earlier in the week, he filed legal documents in L.A. County Superior Court under the pseudonym Doe. He's basically trying to get a woman named Elizabeth Ruiz to cease and desist from releasing a sex tape that the two of them supposedly filmed while they were alone indoors in Cancun. You kind of wonder, like, you've never seen this type of thing from a guy. I mean, I don't know. Like, a lot of the people who actually release sex tapes who act like it's a mistake, I don't really think that a lot of those are mistakes. It was actually the best thing that ever happened to Kim Kardashian, because look at her now. She's a multimillionaire who gets a lot of money to do a lot of nothing. And I'm not knocking it, because if I could do a lot of nothing and make the kind of money that she can make, I'd do a lot of nothing and go to the bank and cash my checks. But for someone like her, I think it was like the greatest thing that could ever happen to her. Von Miller, on the other hand, this is usually something, I guess, in today's society you would expect from a woman who doesn't want this thing to be seen. Like, I heard people, I talked to some people and I was reading some stuff on social media, and people were kind of asking, like, why is Von Miller so pressed to stop this tape from coming out? Like, is it something that he doesn't want people to see? Is it, you know, was he not putting in work? You know, is his guy smaller than he wants to for the ladies to see out in public? I don't know. These aren't my questions, but it is interesting to see. But she's trying to sell the video back to Von Miller for $2.5 million. So what he's calling it is exactly what it is. It's an extortion. I don't know. That's the problem with being a recognizable world famous athlete, and you go to places like Cancun or places such as that and get with randoms thinking that they may not know who you are, but they know. And this is the kind of stuff that some women, I'm not going to say all women, but you know, some people have ulterior motives, and this is the kind of thing that can happen to you when you're out there dealing with them randoms. So shout out to Von Miller. I hope, you know, this doesn't hurt your career in any way. I'm sure it wouldn't, even if it came out, but there's something embarrassing that he doesn't want shown on that, or he's just a normal human being that just doesn't want the public seeing him have sex. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think it's pretty normal. So shout out to Von Miller. I hope it goes your way. LeBron and Phil Jackson are in the news. It's a little bit of beef, a little bit of tension going on there. And this is one of those stories, like, I'm salty that my brothers aren't around to talk about this with me. And hold up, maybe they are, because oh no, I thought I saw B. Austin on the switchboard. B, if you're calling in, press the one so I can get to you. But this is one of those stories that I wish they were around to talk about. And yeah, B is here to talk about it with me. What up, B. Austin?
Yo, I'm live from the War Room Sports War Report wagon. I'm patrolling these streets.
He's mobile with it. Yeah, I was just about to
mobile
get into the whole LeBron James, Phil Jackson thing, and I'm glad that you called in at this particular time, because this is really something I didn't want to get my Dan Patrick on. I didn't want to talk about this by myself. So Phil Jackson was talking about LeBron James for whatever reason in November. The Knicks aren't even playing the Cavaliers anytime soon. But he was talking about LeBron James in an interview, and he was talking about the things he heard about LeBron when he was in Miami. And he mentioned how LeBron, when they went to play Cleveland, you know, he wanted to go, I believe he said he wanted to go a day early, and he wanted to stay an extra day after the game because he and his posse, you know, wanted to stay home for a little while. Regardless of what he said and what he was talking about, the story is around the word posse. LeBron and Maverick Carter, for that matter, took exception to the word posse. And before we even get into it, first of all, the first thing we have to know here is you're dealing with old folks, because nobody in the free world uses the word posse anymore. But what did you think, B. Austin? Did you think this was racially motivated? Because LeBron James seems to think it was a little bit racially motivated. Maverick Carter didn't say those exact things. So I don't know if he really thought it was about race, but what are your thoughts? Because this has been a conversation all week.
I don't think that from Phil Jackson's perspective, it was racially motivated at all. I don't think that Phil Jackson I don't know Phil Jackson personally. We got to say that, although I'm sure that he does tune in to listen to the War Room, as you should, at warroomsports.com. However, so there's a slippery slope that's created in this country, and before LeBron James was LeBron James, a multi-million dollar superstar athlete and face of the NBA, he was a black kid from Akron, Ohio, from the inner city, right? And so while one could say LeBron and his posse, like what I did there, are being overly sensitive, I would throw back on that person and say that LeBron James and his group did not create the situation that allows them to pull the race card in this. I would say that one has to be sensitive to the socio-political climate that we're in right now today, and after years and years and years of burying our heads in the sand and acting like the racial divide, you know, is going away and that we live in a post-racial society, it's evident and apparent that we do not. So if a black man in 2016, after what we see going on in America and in the world over, is sensitive to being disrespected, and he points to the fact that it could be racially motivated, then based on what I see, you know, and you could call me biased, but based on what I see, that claim has legitimacy. And here's why. Posse was something that was used in the 90s amongst people in hip-hop culture. And so it became synonymous with entourage. Instead of an entourage, you're rolling with your posse, mid-90s. You know, early 90s. Okay, I get it.
The 80s, early 90s.
Rich Paul and Maverick Carter are business dynamos on Madison Avenue and in Hollywood in their own right. They took the hand up that LeBron gave them, and they ran with it. they're independently wealthy. They're I can't call them independently successful, but they're largely successful of their own merits and talent. They are far, far from someone's entourage.
Right, and that's the word right there, B, that I get out of it. Like, he was trying to call them an entourage. Like, first thing you think of, the first person you think of when you think of something like this, maybe like an Allen Iverson. So for me, I don't know if it was necessarily racial undertones, but I do think that he was disrespecting them and he was kind of diminishing them to just some lackeys or just some entourage. LeBron's partners used his fame and his success to educate themselves and make themselves dynamos in the business world. So it's difficult, especially at this point, to just diminish their roles and just call them a crew, a posse, an entourage or something like that. Now, LeBron was saying, well, if you look up the word, if you look up the word, there's really nothing racially motivated by the dictionary definition of the word posse. But I can understand how you would think it was racially motivated because of what you said, B, because it was heavily used in the late 80s, early 90s by black rappers. So, you know, Phil Jackson, being the old guy that he is, probably still uses words like that. And I would probably bet that had he been talking about J.J. Redick and his guys, he may or may not have used such a term, but I think more than it being racial, I just think it was very disrespectful.
He's not calling Dougie McDermott's homies a posse. He's not calling Luke Ridenour. Oh, Luke ain't in the league no more. Fuck that. He's not calling.
He might
Chris
be.
Kamen
Luke always somewhere for some reason.
He's not calling. And so, whether this is racially motivated or not, you have an older white man having a public discourse or dialogue with young, successful, rich black men. And throughout the history of this country, if you look at where disrespect towards young black men have come from, I can understand where LeBron comes from. I'm not even saying that he's right, but if you punch me in the face 100 times and I perceive you to raise your fist, you can't get mad if I flinch. You can't. So, you know, that's what he represents. And then on the other side of that, let's take even taking race out of it. As you said earlier, it was disrespectful. And instead of acknowledging it, Phil being the type of person he is, who he likes to be the smartest person in the room, took the smartest person in smug approach, and he subtweeted and retweeted something called the Posse Foundation Incorporated, which has done some charitable work or whatever in trying to say that, here, see, posse doesn't have a negative connotation, you know. And Phil is a smart guy, so I'm also not keen on giving him the "I'm too old to understand" excuse. I'm not going to give him the "I'm Phil, I'm senile" excuse. Nah. You know what time it is. You know you were being disrespectful. And even if people are looking at it in out of context, meaning racially motivated, which it isn't necessarily, dude, the climate has been created for that. It's a problem in this country, and it's not LeBron's fault that he chose to take it that way.
Maverick Carter said, "Let me be clear. I'm not saying Phil Jackson is racist. I'm calling out his disrespectful language," because he pointed out that he could have, you know, he could say whatever he wants about LeBron as a basketball player. He's like, I wouldn't care. He said it's the word posse and the characterization I take offense to. If he would have said LeBron and his agent, LeBron and his business partners, or LeBron and his friends, that's one thing. Yet because you're young and black, he can use the word. He said, we're grown men. But I have the actual transcript, because Phil Jackson was being interviewed for ESPN by, I believe it may have been Jackie McMullen, I'm not sure, but he was talking about Pat Riley, and that's how it came up. He said it had to hurt when they lost LeBron. That was definitely a slap in the face. But there were a lot of little things that came out of that. When LeBron was playing with the Heat, they went to Cleveland and he wanted to spend the night. They don't do overnights. Teams just don't. So now Coach Spoelstra has to text Riley and say, what do I do in this situation? And Pat, who has iron fist rules, answers, you are on the plane. You are with this team. You can't hold up the whole team because you and your mom and your posse want to spend an extra night in Cleveland. I always thought Pat had this really nice vibe with his guys, but something happened there where it broke down. I do know LeBron likes special treatment. He needs things his way. And that's another thing Maverick has said. He said, you know, I don't mind him saying LeBron needs special treatment, because in some ways that's true. You can't treat everyone the same. You know what I'm saying? And only good coaches, good franchises, you know, good organizations know that kind of thing. You can't treat LeBron the same way you treat James Jones. Like, it's just not possible. But he said he had no qualms with that. It was just the disrespect in the language that he used. And that's the same way I see it. Like, I really don't know if I see it as it being racist. It definitely has racial undertones because of who we said used that word heavily in the late right. 80s, early 90s. But I just think he was just dismissing his group as just some hangers-on when these dudes are a whole lot more than that. Like, we give LeBron's homies, we give them props all the time for what they've done with the platform that they've
Stan,
been given.
I can't capture the words verbatim, but Stan Van Gundy offered some thoughts and commentary on this, and he said, I'm going to be honest, you know, I've used the term in reference to people's entourages, and I've never used it in reference to a white player's entourage. And I know why, and I'm going to have to do better on it. And I'm paraphrasing. I don't have it verbatim, but essentially he's acknowledging the point that you made earlier that, you know, while I'm sure it's going to make some folks uncomfortable to make this discussion about race, but unfortunately, that's the world we live in.
Mm-hmm.
That's the world we live in. So it's kind of like, okay, are we calling Phil Jackson a racist? Hell no. But it has to be acknowledged that there is some racial overtone in that, and Stan Van Gundy kind of kept it real and called it what it is. Shout out to Chris Broussard and Shannon Sharp, the great Shannon Sharp, who knew. Because they were having the same discussion today, and Broussard was the person that brought up Stan Van Gundy and Stan Van Gundy's comments with regards to this. So you got some people out here who are willing to be candid and willing to be honest with their discussion. And Phil's approach to this, which is going to be consistent with who he is, you know, Phil's a prideful, haughty person, as he should be. I mean, he won 11 chips, so... You know, he takes the approach, I'm not even going to acknowledge that I said something wrong or that I should apologize. Instead, I'm going to double down and I'm going to use Twitter, which is another thing that knocks him out of the old and senile conversation. If you're using Twitter and you know how to use Twitter, you ain't old. You may
oh, no,
be
it's
old
definitely,
years,
it's definitely,
but you ain't old.
We definitely can't chalk anything up to him being old besides the word that he chose to use, but it's definitely not an old and senile moment. Phil Jackson is very intelligent, and everything he says is calculated. He knows what he said.
Right.
He knows what he was doing. But speaking of racists and who could possibly be one, man, even if you're trying to make yourself think that our president-elect might not be, and he might have just been playing the role for his base, he goes and does something else that just completely, you know, makes you think, okay, that might not be the case. He might just be one of those things, especially, you know, with the people he's hiring to run his cabinet. But we're not even going to speak on that. What we are going to speak on is how his win is still affecting the sports world, because at least three NBA teams have decided to stop staying at Donald Trump branded hotels in New York and Chicago, where his name is on a couple of hotels through licensing agreements. But they want to stop doing it in part to avoid any implied association, because, you know, anybody in the past week who's done anything that had anything to do with Donald Trump, whether they do ride for him or not, they've come under scrutiny. They've come under fire. So teams are like, look, we are not going to stay in Trump hotels because we are not going to have people picketing us when we come out of the hotel to go to our game. So one of the teams is the Milwaukee Bucks. The other is the Memphis Grizzlies. And the last one is the Dallas Mavericks. They've moved away from staying in Trump hotels when they visit New York and Chicago. Sources say there's another Eastern Conference team that is under contract to stay at the Trump Soho in New York, which is, he doesn't even own that. That's just another something else with his name associated to it. But yeah, so when people go play the Knicks, the Nets, or the Bulls, you know, they're trying to get out of these contracted hotel stays in Trump properties, Trump-owned properties, or Trump-licensed properties. What are your thoughts on this? Like, how would you handle this? Would this be something you would do if you were the powers that be for an NBA franchise? All right. I guess I lost B. Elson. B, you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Oh, I don't know.
Brother, when you're talking about the president, he has his finger, the president-elect, he now has his finger on the pulse of certain things where, you know,
I don't remember meeting you. You still mobile, right?
Yes, sir.
I have no clue how that happened then. So if you were the powers that be for an NBA franchise, would you make this move as well? Would you stop, you know, keeping your team in Trump hotels when you visit these cities?
Yes, absolutely. But I also have to acknowledge my bias. So, you know, based on who I am, even from the context of business, which, you know, I like to think that every member of the War Room Sports family, at least on this show, has a pretty accomplished business acumen. But, you know, even socially and what my belief system is, I'd have to stop. You know, I can't be a party to anything that supports, you know, the economic value and growth of his brand. So yeah, my team could not.
Right. And that's cool. And because you spoke on like what your beliefs would be, like what you believed in. I think it's a situation because I'm pretty sure that somebody high up in these NBA franchises, if not the owner himself, you know, probably support Donald Trump. It's a business decision in the fact that. Yeah, it's a business move in the fact that you want to be you want to avoid being lumped in. First of all, if everybody's been following the news this week, it seems like the white nationalist groups are just claiming things. Like, you don't even have to have those intentions. Like, the white nationalist group have people boycotting New Balance now for stuff that New Balance never said. You know what I'm saying? One guy from New Balance came out and said, well, the Obama administration pretty much ignored the trade agreement that they were opposed to, full disclosure, because New Balance is a shoe manufacturer who still makes their shoes in America. Most major shoe brands don't. So, of course, they're not in favor of the trade agreement that allows the other shoe companies to do that. So Donald Trump opposes this trade agreement, as did Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders. But the fact that Donald won, the executive from New Balance spoke his name saying, I'm glad that he opposes this because the Obama administration pretty much ignored us on this. So people lost their minds. People are on on social media burning New Balance sneakers and throwing them in the trash. So they had to bring out a statement saying in no way were they saying that they were affiliated with Trump, because the neo-Nazis came out and said New Balance is now the official shoe of white nationalists. You can't just go Brody your own endorsement. Like, that's not what they were saying. But having them come out there and just rough things like that, that's why you have to, whether you support the dude or not, if you're looking to do good business, you have to distance yourself from anything Trump, because the white nationalist neo-Nazi groups are out there just claiming things. So if they see that these teams are still staying at Trump hotels, the next thing they're going to say is, man, the Milwaukee Bucks and the, you know, whoever else, the Memphis Grizzlies and such are the official basketball teams of white nationalists because they stay at the official hotels of the neo-Nazis. So you got to distance yourself from this no matter what your political beliefs are.
Man, idiocy reigns supreme on social media. Jeez Louise. And for those of you who are listening for the first time or have not been with us for so long, Yes, we are a sports-themed and sports-based show, but unfortunately, or fortunately, sports touches every phase of life. And so we have to have these dialogues and these discussions about Trump because it's completely pertinent to what's going on in sports today and the world at large. So we got to talk about it. We have to, man. We got to talk about it. It's affecting our athletes. It's affecting the fan base.
Breaking news. Actually, I was going to discuss this stuff and hot topics, but he hadn't been named yet. But shout out to Mike Trout for winning the 2016 American League MVP. I told y'all earlier in the year that he's my favorite player, just because I found out, you know, he's an Eagles fan. So shout out to Mike Trout.
True.
He's from up the way. I think he's from Jersey, but it's all good. Jersey
greatest,
is close enough.
Greatest basketball, greatest baseball player, rather, in the league right now because he's an Eagles fan. My position on Trump, even in sports, because we're going to talk, I'm sure, later on about the locker room divides that are occurring. But my position on Trump, man, is I'm actually, and I've said this, you know, on air, and I think at one time folks thought that I was saying it in jest, but, you know, I really am halfway happy that Trump won, because my position is what we are seeing in terms of response and support for Donald Trump, to me, that's the real America. This is really where we live. This is who and what we are. And the longer, you know, you have moderates or Democrats or, you know, folks that don't stand the way Trump stands, the longer you have them in office, the less likely you are to have true, real, honest assessment and conversation about where this nation is with its treatment of minorities and protected classes. I think that he makes the dialogue, intentionally or unintentionally, he forces the dialogue upon us. This is who and what we are. Now we got to deal with it. We can't sing America the brave and America, even your slogan, Make America Great Again. When was it great for everybody? You know, so I think that this is really going to either further develop the character of the country positively or further develop the character of the country negatively, because now there's no more hiding. There is no more. Right. We live in a post-racial society. So.
Yeah. I mean, there was none of that when people were saying that bull. Nobody believed that. All right. So LeBron, one more thing, and shout out to him for this. LeBron James has decided to donate $2.5 million to support the exhibit honoring Muhammad Ali at the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture in Washington, D.C. This is interesting that this came up, because I actually had the opportunity last Friday on Veterans Day to visit the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture. It's been, of course, it's the museum that's in most demand right now, because if everybody doesn't know the whole landscape of the Smithsonian in Washington, D.C., all Smithsonian museums and exhibits are free. The African American History Museum is free as well. However, the demand is so high to see this place, which it's a great place. The demand is so high that you have to actually go to their website and, like, I hear, and put in for tickets like 3 months in advance. Like, for instance, like if you go to their website right now, they'll probably tell you. Matter of fact, somebody told me, because they were asking, like, you know, how'd you get a ticket? This and that and this and that. Like, what? I took like 10 people in my family went, but you know, War Room Sports, that's what we do.
Yeah, everybody looking like you, exclusive VIP.
Yeah, so somebody told me that they went on the website 2 days ago, and it says all tickets for the museum, our time tickets are sold out through March. And I use the word sold out even though they're free. So they're given out. I hear if you go, like, they give out maybe 1,000 tickets every morning at 9 a.m. But I hear that the line for that 9 a.m. They're getting concert tickets or playoff tickets to go to this free museum. It was definitely, a wonderful place. And especially for Black people, I encourage everybody to go see it. But I encourage everyone, not just Black people, to go see it, spend a whole day, read, you know, listen, take your time. And understand, because it'll give an understanding to those folks who don't understand the Black plight in America that started over 400 years ago and is still going on today. You know, a lot of people like to dismiss it, but you know, if you put everything together and you go through that whole museum, you'll start to understand systemic happenings that have been going on in this country for a long time. But the Muhammad Ali exhibit is actually a huge exhibit. They have, once you go into the sports area on, I believe, the third floor of the museum, might be, it's either the third or the fourth. I know the music and sports is on third, three and four. But inside the sports exhibit, they have a boxing room. Now, while you're in the boxing room, you'll see a window for another room, and that's Muhammad Ali's exhibit. He has his own room to himself, because we all know that Muhammad Ali was far more than just a boxer. So in a museum such as this one, I think he most certainly deserves more than just being a face on the wall in the boxing room or a statue in the boxing room. So I don't know what more $2.5 million is going to add to it, but we do know that's Smithsonian works on donations and government funding and things like that. So shout out to LeBron for acknowledging one of his heroes, one of all of our heroes. And what LeBron said, he said, every professional athlete, regardless of race and gender, owes a huge debt of gratitude to Muhammad Ali. His legacy deserves to be studied and revered by every generation. I'm honored to partner with the Smithsonian to celebrate one of the most influential figures in our nation's history, who, along with Jackie Robinson and Jesse Owens, used the power of sports to advance our civil rights. So that's what's up. Shout out to LeBron. Getting points in my book every day, man, every day.
The one thing that I can say is, you know, we've looked at a couple of cultural icons across sports and hip hop, where, you know, we've had this dialogue and what that the premise of the dialogue, Dev, is that particular person is so big and so successful in what they do, they could choose to make a social statement and change the tide, and it wouldn't cost them their wealth, their generational wealth, and their fortune to make a small sacrifice and take a stand.
And a lot of those folks choose not to do that because they're so afraid that the checks will stop flowing in that they don't want to take that risk. I don't think LeBron has got there yet. I think that he checks the Q rating on his actions and says, all right, it's time, and this has a net positive effect. But I do see him taking steps and strides to a place where I believe that at some point we could see LeBron say, I don't care anymore because you can't take this money, financial, and economic success away from me. So I'm going to make stands and I'm going to make statements that are a risk to my immediate cash flow because this is what I stand for. I could see him becoming a Kareem Abdul-Jabbar on steroids. I could see him becoming a John Brown on steroids. I could even see him becoming a Muhammad Ali, not on steroids, because I believe Muhammad Ali surpasses LeBron in terms of social reach. But I could see him, of all athletes and entertainers, making it there. What do you think about that?
I mean, I definitely can see him make it there. I mean, we've always talked about, I'm going to keep it 100 right now, and we've always talked about whether or not the things LeBron does, like, are they contrived or not? Contrived or not, they're being done. So there's a portion of the population that's benefiting from the things that he's doing, whether it's deeply coming from his heart or not. You know, whether it's just LeBron having good handlers and knowing how to position him for the long haul, or if this stuff is coming from the heart. So either way it goes, you know, I got to give him his props, and I do think he can become, you know, that person, especially through financial means, because he has a whole lot more money to throw around than some of our greats, like, you know, Muhammad Ali and guys like that. So it's obvious that you're not going to get any athlete in today's society who's going to go to bat with his career, reputation, life, et cetera, like a Muhammad Ali and some guys from his time. But these guys are in great financial positions to push positivity along. So shout out to LeBron for that. Like, let me give some quick birthday shout outs, tell everybody how they can get in touch with us.
No doubt.
Then I know we got some calls on the line. I see we got Tobias waiting, we got Rob waiting. Give us like 3 more minutes, fellas. We will get to the phone line. So birthdays, of course, are brought to you by Digital Extreme Technologies. Do you or your business need a custom website? Well, for dynamic, professional, and most of all, affordable custom website solutions, you need Digital Extreme Technologies. No need to break the bank for an effective online presence. Top quality results-driven websites at incredibly affordable prices. And yes, financing options are available. So visit digitalextremetech.com or call 267-205-4203. Again, that's 267-205-4203. And for discounted rates, be sure to tell them that War Room Sports sent
you. My birthday. Yay!
All right. We want to give a shout-out to MLB. I'm not going to call him a legend or anything, but shout-out to Nick Markakis, who turns 33. Shout out to Ryan Braun, who could have been a legend until he got the whole PED situation. He turns 33. Ryan Braun was on a trajectory to be, you know, one of the greats. And yeah, he's still a pretty good player, but I don't know. The PEDs smear you, and he definitely hasn't been that guy since serving his diesel suspension for that. Shout out to what could be a future Hall of Fame NFL wide receiver, Reggie Wayne, turns 38. I didn't know Reggie Wayne was this old. I don't think I realized that, because Reggie Wayne was just playing like last year.
We old, man.
Yeah, that might be the thing. Speaking of Hall of Fame, man, shout out to our dude, the homie Brian Dawkins, because he has become a finalist. So I think that means, because they were celebrating him, I guess your man McNabb didn't make it past the semifinal stage, which is crazy. Because the reason I thought of that, I'm not even thinking of it to diss him, but it's gonna be a diss, because I thought about Reggie Wayne at 38 and me saying maybe he's a borderline Hall of Famer. And then I'm thinking of Donovan McNabb and all the people that we argue with that says he's a surefire Hall of Famer, but like he couldn't even make it to 38 in the NFL. Like he didn't make it past what, 32, 33 with a
he was out of the league at 33.
Starting. Yeah, I mean he was backing up cats like Ponder at 33. And yeah, so I'm not even gonna get into that whole situation. It's just weird to me how people think he's a fire Hall of Famer, and all his contemporaries have like 30,000 to 40,000 more yards than he has. Like it's crazy. Well, shout out to Brian Dawkins and shout out to Reggie Wayne on his 38th birthday. Butch Davis, shout out to him. He turned 65. NBA legend Elvin Hayes turned 71, and MLB legend Tom Seaver turned 72. So we'd like to give a nice big War Room salute to all of these folks on their special day. Salute from the War Room, good people.
Yay!
All right, and real quick before we get into hot topics and take these phone calls, you guys can check out our website at warroomsports.com. While you're there, take your time, get your click on, look around, click on the Contact Us tab, send us a message about our company, our show, to inquire about sponsorship and advertising opportunities, or join in the network in any capacity. For general inquiries, email us, info@warroomsports.com. While you're browsing the site, click on the memorabilia tab to buy War Room Sports merchandise. Click the blog tab to read our latest articles on All Fair and Sports and More blog. Then click the respective icons and tabs to like our Facebook page, to follow us on Twitter, subscribe to our iTunes podcast, to watch our webcast at War Room Sports TV, or to listen to the WRS Podcast Network, or to download our free War Room Sports mobile app to get everything I just mentioned on the go. Join the JW Philly Realty chat room right now during the show. That's blogtalkradio.com/thewarroom to enter the chat room. Sign up for a free profile on Blog Talk Radio. If you don't want to do that, you can sign in through your Facebook and Twitter accounts. And while you're at it, click follow. That'll get you updates and reminders about the show. We'll be taking questions and reading posts from Facebook, Twitter, and the chat room. So if you want to call in and speak with us, now is the time. The Digital Extreme Technologies hotline is now open. That number is 323-410-0012. Press 1 when prompted. If you're already listening from your phone, just press 1 if you want to talk. People, is your schedule too hectic to read as much as you want? Try audiobooks. Kick back and let someone else do the reading for you. All you got to do is visit Audible. Sign up for your free trial at audibletrial.com/warroomsports. In no time, you could be listening to the latest bestsellers hands-free, stress-free, while getting other things done at the very same time. And this would be a great time for you guys to sign up at Audible. Get that free trial from your boys over here at War Room Sports, because we just started the War Room Sports Book Club. If you are on Facebook, join the group. The group is called WRS Book Club. It's a closed group. Just go ask for membership, and we will let you in the book club. The club is being run by our girl Sharon Taylor. Shout out to you, Sharon, for running the book club for us. And she is already trying to get together with everybody that's already in the group on the first book that they want to read. I believe it's called Queen Sugar. It's a novel by Natalie Bazile. So, yes, if you're in the War Room Sports Book Club, that doesn't mean you're just going to be reading books about sports. So tell your homies, tell your ladies, tell your friends. It's a book. It's a legitimate book club. It's just because it's done by a sports company doesn't mean we're going to be reading the autobiography of Wilt Chamberlain and the Book of Basketball by.
That's probably one of the
Bill
greatest.
Simmons.
Think of the numbers. Oh, never mind.
I'm not saying that will never come up, but I'm just saying it's a legitimate book club. So tell your ladies to join as well. Was that sexist? Am I like assuming that ladies don't want to read about sports? I wasn't trying to do that. I wasn't trying to get my Trump on. But, shoot, I don't want to read about sports no more. So, anyway, before we get into these hot topics, let's go to the phone line, because we had some people waiting for a while. We got Tobias calling from Arizona. Roll damn Tide. What's up, Tobias?
Roll damn Tide. Hey, my new job, boy. I used to work evenings and stuff. Now,
got a training class, so I got off early. Had to shout you guys out. How's it going?
Pretty good, man. How are you?
Oh, man. We always love Let's Be Honest here gets in the war room, brother. We wait for this.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And I'm finna be honest with y'all real quick. I'm gonna be super petty right now. Hey, LeBron James, I know Phil was talking slick about you, but in the words of LeBron James, I need all the facts first. Shout out to rest in peace to Tamir Rice. But,
Yo, you petty wop, man.
Hey, that's all I got to say. But you know what? Now, I didn't vote for Trump. I didn't vote for Hillary because I believe that she's a covert white supremacist with all the – hey, it had a track record of policy.
We are super predators.
But, yeah, so all these black folks, like my Buccaneer, Mike Evans, sitting down. I'm like, dude, it's one thing when Kaepernick did it because it was protesting, hey, unarmed black folks being killed with impunity. Mike Evans just pouting because Donald Trump won. And I'm like this. And here's the thing. All these NBA guys are mad now. How come none of y'all stood with Kaepernick when he protested? Where were they at then?
Nah, I feel you. I feel you. This seems like it's easier because everybody's doing it. Like, Colin Kaepernick took a stand that was not popular at all. You know what I'm saying? Got backlash for it. This seems a lot more convenient because really the only people who are going to get upset about this are the people who ride for Donald Trump. And everybody's pretty much dismissed all of them as being racist at this point anyway. So I don't think anybody cares about that kind of backlash. So, yeah, I get what you're saying, man. I get what you're saying.
Yeah.
I hear
yeah.
you.
Yeah, here's the thing. Hey, let me break this to black people real quick. Sports-wise, regular folks-wise, most of your white politicians are bigots. That white guy who negotiated your salary, your job, is a racist. Let me be honest here, guys. I hate to break it to y'all. Who had nothing to say with all our black folks getting killed in the street with impunity, nothing to say when black folks can't get jobs or access to capital, or these white feminists who had nothing to say when black women work the same jobs, got just as many college degrees, but make a substantially less money? We should be in the street protesting with them. Let them have at it by themselves. We're being used again. And I'm just keeping it real with you guys. But
I mean, we are
protesting
people. Like I just mentioned earlier, like I just went to...
Yeah.
I just visited the African American History Museum in D.C. You know, you go through there, if you didn't know already, which, you know, most of us should be educated enough to know, like, we are a protesting, marching-ass people. And it seems like you said, it's hard to get everybody to step with our calls. I'm not saying that, you know, there are no whites and there are no feminists or there are no this and that who step with our causes and protest with us, because there are. But they're not out there in like record numbers, but they damn sure want us out there stepping with them when something goes down. And, you know, we do.
Yeah.
We do.
Yeah. And I'll say this before I make a sports point and I go, because they got robbing a lot. That's where black folks mess up at. We got to be strategic. Hey, if this man talking about maybe a New Deal 2.0, I'm not talking about the Chitlin and the pastors. I'm not talking about your Roland Martins who look pretty pitiful the day after the election, those types. Go out there and say, okay, what you going to do? What are you going to do? But see, the problem is that, like, I'm going to post this on your walls. There's a black man in Michigan, Detroit, who owned a restaurant, and he actually catered. Like, his Donald Trump's son had an event there. And black folks there protesting him.
They're
and I'm like, y'all
putting
the poor guy out of work.
Yeah, they boycotting him.
Yeah. And he probably provided black folks jobs, but y'all ain't mad at Air Jordans. Y'all ain't mad.
Now,
at
now
the
I
Rock.
Didn't. I saw that headline and I stashed it away. I haven't read it yet. So was he just doing business, or did he cater it because he was supporting Trump? Like, what's the story? What has everybody upset?
Well, I look at his business. He took pictures with him and stuff like that with his son. His son had the event. But black folks are mad that he served, he did business with them, period. And I'm like, no. You do business with whoever paying the foot in the bill. And here's another thing. You can probably get a lot of good information if you do some business there, you know. But I got a sports take real quick before I go. First things first, I told y'all LSU won another roll tide. But here's the thing. You know, I'm looking at sports right now. I'm looking at it. It's like, especially at the NBA. Golden State is in trouble this year, guys. I know they got the offense, but they lost so much size. And that size is going to hurt them come playoff time.
They can't protect the rim. They can't protect the rim. As much as I hated Festus Ezeli, he had some value backing up Bogut, and you get rid of both of them. Can't protect the rim.
And see, that's an underrated thing, because that's LeBron's kryptonite, protecting the rim. That's why the Spurs gave him trouble. Those Bulls teams before Rose got hurt. The Pacers, they had people that protected the rim, made them shoot jumpers. And I say this real quick before I go, guys. Joel Embiid is going to be a good player in this league, but too bad you probably end up having to take like a pack of bubble gum and a two-piece of Popeyes for Jahlil Okafor. Sorry. And if Jimmy was there, I would ask Jimmy, where all those Laker fans at who said, oh, we got to take Jahlil Okafor over to D'Angelo Russell? Where are they at right now?
Yeah, he balling. Jahlil Okafor is still pretty – he's pretty nice in his own right. He ain't playing no defense on nobody, but he's just like Embiid. He's on minutes restrictions right now. So, but he was that dude last night in their second win of the season against the Wizards. I'm not going to make a judgment on either one of them quite
yet. It's too early, man. Yeah,
it's way too early to say who made the mistake, because I mean, hey, you never know, especially
because
I don't know. Like I think I've watched every Sixers game so far this season, but I don't think there's been one time that Joel Embiid and Jahlil Okafor has been on the floor at the same time, because they're both on minutes restrictions and you're missing all your other big men. So you have to swap them out to get a full game, you know, minutes wise. So they haven't been on the floor together. Think about how easy Joel Embiid is going to make things for Jahlil Okafor on the other block. So I don't want to make that, you know, distinction just yet. D'Angelo's definitely more exciting right now because he's a guard. He's doing the thing, but I don't want to make that distinction yet. And you know the Lakers always make their hay off having a great big man. So I guess
you got to be careful because with who D'Angelo Russell hangs out with, he can end up buried in a shallow grave in Las Vegas for telling on the wrong people.
I know y'all from Philly, so needs to say he might not want to snitch on the Morris twins. That's all I got to say.
That's
what them dudes. They're crazy.
Hey.
Yo, they beat up a dude that I used to ball with back in the day. Like he was supposed to be like their manager or something, and he did something that they didn't like. They petty,
he
man.
Was,
they grown men. They still rolling on people, man. They jumping people.
And they Bentley, by the way.
Yeah.
Hey, I know you guys got other people, man. You guys be good. Hey, I say this. I love the things you're doing with the show, because I love the fact that you got black people. I know it's blog talking. You guys are growing, but I love the fact that it's black owned and controlled, and it's not being a shield and like just pee footing around. I'm trying to make sure the word ain't being. I'm glad you guys keep it raw
and honest. We're going to talk about it. We're going to talk about it. We know some of the stuff we talk about and the amount of times we talk about it probably turns some of the listeners off and some of the supporters, but some things need to be talked about, so we're going to talk about it.
Because at the end of the day, we're black, guys.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, we're black here, and you guys have a good one, man. And I'll get to call you guys again soon, man.
All right, man. Talk to you next week. Goodbye.
All right, peace.
Yeah, that's what's up. Like, we love all of our supporters and listeners, but like he just said,
man,
at the end of the day, you do have to realize we're black, so we have black problems, so we have to talk about our black problems on our platform. So, you know, we don't mean to turn anybody off, but it is what it is. Let's go out to Rob in Cali. Rob, what's going on?
Hello, can y'all hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. What's up?
Yo, what's up, man? What's up, man? Your boy Big Rob.
AKK.
Yo, I put that H on you. You want that old thing back. Yo, AKA. Yo, styles upon styles upon styles upon I have. Yo, got that album. AKA.
Oh, yeah.
Make America Great Again. These nuts. Yo.
Make America Hate Again. Out in the open. So what's up, Rob?
Yo, man, it's a lot. It's a lot. Excuse me for last time because I was really excited. And I was too, kind of too, because, you know, a lot's happening, you know. Every day I wake, it's like a Facebook post that every day you wake up, it's like a Facebook post that my friend said, it's hard to sleep in Trump America, especially for minority. And I agree a lot of things with Beyonce saying, and I was kind of like, like I saw a ghost or something when B. Austin said, yo, Trump is talking to Rudy Giuliani, one of our messages. I'm like, oh, shit. You know, like just when you think it couldn't get any worse. But I do like this because in a lot of my, it's kind of like Facebook has been, or social media, or let's just say Facebook, it's been created to where you're preaching to a choir, because a lot of friends I know, they kind of stop being friends with a lot of the progressive friends. Either they're obnoxiously ignorant friends, or just like, I mean, people show their true colors. You know, when the grass is low, the snakes shall show. You know what I'm saying? And people show their true colors with this Trump stuff. And I mean, I understand that Hillary will go into World War III. I understand that. At the same time, it's like all the pressure, everything's gonna be falling on us, and it's just like a dark day in America. It's like the Death Star on like you know what I'm saying? On the planet.
You call him Emperor Palpatine?
Man, Emperor Palpatine. Yeah, it's like the Revenge of the Sith, man. It's like when they killed, and they killed the black dude first. They killed the first Jedi Master that died was Samuel Jackson. And they jumped him. But anyway, yo. Yeah, so.
You know how that
yeah,
go.
And you know what? Because I'm really good at sports, I really think California secession will come in the future, because when you're talking about reproductive rights, in the most liberal state in the country, and how our economy works, and how by ourselves we could be like the top 10 economies in the world by ourselves, California. You know, Trump is really pushing that envelope, and I will see how the California legislators, you know, do. But you know, but anyway. On a basketball, yeah, I like D'Angelo Russell. He's doing all right. You know, he's keeping his mouth shut and doing okay. But, I mean, the big thing is that, to be honest, I wanted Emmanuel Mudiay.
Really?
Because I thought he was.
Why? Number two?
Emmanuel Mudiay,
that
yeah.
That would have been a huge gamble at number two, though.
He played with grown men.
He's only been playing basketball for like 3 years. He is tremendously athletic.
Exactly.
I mean,
he played the Lakers.
Everybody got an opinion. You want who you want.
We played Lakers. He had, you know, dimes. And you know what? I never liked, what's his name, Mike D'Antoni. Yes, is James Harden putting up super numbers while not playing defense? You know, that's good, but at the same time, you know, his this is not the NCAA. This is the NBA. His offense, to me, is just built for college. You know, that's just me. But on the Sunday, all of my Eagles, I don't know if they can win this one. And the only way they're going to win this game is special teams.
Yeah, did they surprise you on Sunday with the Falcons win? Or was the Falcons – are the Falcons just an overrated bunch?
No, I mean, any given Sunday, you know, we're playing at home. It was – I mean, those two drives that Julio Jones had could have changed – could have easily changed the perplexity of this game. Now, I do like – I do think that DBs are immature. Like, they have to stop celebrating after every play. That's just getting ridiculous now.
No,
you
know?
I think they did a great job. It's one guy
that celebrates. And they do a great job, but it's only one guy that celebrates, Rob. And his name is Mills. And he has green hair. And
he celebrates a little too much. But all things considered, I think they did a pretty good job, even on Julio Jones, even though he had like 8 receptions for over 100 yards. Dude, you're still, I mean, just because you know what he's capable of. We know he's not going to go out and get 300 yards every game, but he's capable of getting 300 yards and 250 yards receiving and one or two touchdowns. So to keep him, it was kind of the same thing with like Antonio Brown back with the Steelers. But it was a motorcade going past you, homie. Like, we had Rob, it's loud out there, so we had to let you go. But we'll keep sticking on the point for you. We'll talk to you next week, all right, bro?
All right, Rob.
Yeah, Rob, it must have been a motorcade going by. But what I was saying about the whole Julio Jones thing, it was kind of like how the Eagles played Antonio Brown. You know these guys are going to get their receptions. You're not going to stop that. They might even get their yards.
Right.
But if you can keep them out of getting receptions and yards and meaningful, important situations, and you keep them out of the end zone, then you've done your job. Yeah, you've done your job against these kind of guys. What Antonio Brown did was all in garbage time because the game was a blowout from, you know, almost from jump. This game against the Falcons, you know, Julio Jones got what he got in the flow of the game, but it was never at a point of the game where it was going to hurt you. The only ones that would have hurt, like Rob said, are the two that he dropped. They probably would have hurt because it would have kept them in contention to come back and win the game like Atlanta likes to do. So I think the deep – you would think going into a game like that, you would think, okay, Atlanta has a terrible defense. So you think Philly has to find a way, or any team has to find a way to outscore them because Atlanta's – offense is going to score. However, the defense strapped down on them dudes, and they made who was the front runner for MVP coming into the game, made him look a little pedestrian, made that offense look a little, you know, they got that fluke touchdown late in the game because of Jalen Mills. But, you know, besides that, they didn't really get off any big plays, and they are a offense predicated on big plays. So, you know, shout out to the
predicated
defense.
Predicated on Julio beating his mushroom head on top of your helmet down the field.
Exactly.
I am very impressed with what, man?
Come on, man.
I am very impressed with our defense and the performance they put up. And to be honest, objectively, I don't like Mills' celebratory attitude and the cockiness. I understand you have to be confident when in that position and who you are. And if I take all of that away and the fact that
I think
he's a Beckham, I like his play. He's a six-rounder. He's a six-rounder.
He's an overachiever.
He is starting in the NFL.
They let
him play Julio man up one-on-one. Like, they definitely saw something in that draft film that they got right with him. So, you know, I respect the talent. I respect his ability. I just don't respect his hair. I don't respect his generation. I don't respect his, you know, being a little humbler.
I heard you buzzing back in the day, your whole generation. His whole generation.
Get a little more humble. But he is a hell of a player. And our secondary, man, Brother Malcolm must be holding Salat with these dudes during the week because he got them playing right. He got them playing right.
Speaking of, you know, what you said earlier, like how many times, like when we haven't watched football together this season, like how many times do I text all of y'all, you, Jimmy, PJ, Kill, talking about how Julio is like currently laying something on people's shoulder pads at the moment. Like, you know, it's almost every week. It's almost every week where I turn to a Falcons game and I have to tell y'all, like, yo, Julio is out here stroking people's helmets in the ear hole. Like, that dude is crazy. So, you know, to hold him to that kind of game, the numbers just show you just what he is. Like, okay, on a fairly quiet day, he can get 8 for $1.10 or whatever it is he had. That's just Julio Jones. Right. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You do better than
that. I was impressed with the win, you know, but it kind of makes me angry as a fan and a student of the game because I feel like we have something special at quarterback. And if he messes up, I don't mind because he's a rookie. I don't mind. But he makes the right play 9 times out of 10 and hits these dudes in the hand. And Aguilar just needs to put his mouth on the shotgun and pull the trigger. I mean, Aguilar just – he got to go. He got to go, yo. He is atrocious.
All right, well, let me give some quick MLB shout-outs just for the major awards because, you know, how baseball does. They wait till the World Series is over.
You didn't want me to pick my awards,
No, I don't think we – did we even do this? I don't even remember if we predicted awards, but Terry Francona, Cleveland professional baseball team skipper Terry Francona, he won the AL Manager of the Year. That's his second time in 4 years winning that award. And for the National League, first year manager Dave Roberts of the LA Dodgers won NL Manager of the League. I said Manager of the League, Manager of the Year. The Rookie of the Year awards in the National League went unanimously to Corey Seager, who batted .308 with 26 home runs. And in the American League, Tigers right-hander Michael Fulmer, he went 11-7 with a 3.06 ERA. He got the American League Rookie of the Year. The Cy Young Awards, this was kind of crazy. It was kind of controversial because Justin Verlander had more first-place votes than anyone, but he came in second with the award. And two people didn't even have Justin Verlander on their ballot. I don't understand how that could have gone down. Here we go again with people from the media doing something that has to be personal.
He got treated like Hillary in the popular vote.
But shout out to Rick Porcello, who won his first Cy Young. In the National League, the Nationals' Max Scherzer won the Cy Young, and he's become the sixth pitcher in MLB history to win the Cy Young in both leagues. He won one when he was with Detroit in the AL, and now he's won one with the Washington Nationals. In the National League. And the MVP, the American League MVP, as we stated earlier, Mike Trout, he won his second MVP. He beat out Mookie Betts and Jose Altuve from the Astros. And for the National League, I do not believe they announced the winner yet, but the finalists for the National League MVP is Chris Bryant from the Cubs, Daniel Murphy from the Nationals, Corey Seager from the Dodgers. So we should get that announcement probably sometime in the next few minutes if I haven't missed that already. So shout out to everybody in the MLB. NBA Players of the Week for for the first week of the season, it's not LeBron James. This week we have DeMar DeRozan and James Harden. DeRozan led the Toronto Raptors to a 3-0 week. As a matter of fact, he's leading the NBA in scoring at 34 points per game.
DeMar?
Yeah, DeMar DeRozan is balling so far this year. His game, he just looked like he took a few steps up mentally in the offseason. And his game is a little more smart versus athletic. I mean, it's been trending in this direction for a few years.
We've been talking about it for about half a decade.
Right. Now his game is moving away from just athleticism to, like, DeMar DeRozan is really learning how to play the game of basketball, and it's coming easy to him.
I'm proud of that dude, man. Proud of that dude. I have a high level of respect and regard to our listeners. I know y'all not going to believe us, but when DeMar DeRozan was drafted in the NBA, he was not better than the two people on these microphones. He was more athletic. He could run faster, and he could jump higher, but there's no way that he could shoot a basketball from anywhere better than me. When he came into the league, he was an Olympic track athlete playing basketball. And now, he is possibly top three in the East. I may be a little over. He is tough.
He didn't score under 33 all week. He put together games of 33, 34, and 37 points. He's the first player to score at least 30 points in 8 of his first 9 games since you know who. You want to take a guess at that?
Since God.
Since God. He's in every stat since Michael Jordan in the 86-87 season. James Harden, on the other hand, is balling out of control as well, because in his first 8-9 games of the season, he's proven that his move to point guard might be a stroke of brilliance from Mike D'Antoni. Of course, Mike D'Antoni is not requiring James Harden to play any defense. I watched the Rockets play the Oklahoma City Thunder last night, and I'm turning because there's a million games on, so I'm flipping all the games. But not one time where I was tuned into that game did I see James Harden even attempt to go anywhere near Russell Westbrook's direction on defense. So you know how D'Antoni is. You just score and assist. You don't have to do all that other stuff.
I don't want to take away from it, because offensively, the dude really is amazing. I mean,
he makes it really easy, effortless.
Amazing. He can score effortlessly. But you've been watching ball for a long time. I've been watching ball for a long time. We're very familiar with D'Antoni's system. D'Antoni's system had Raymond Felton putting up like 18-8. How much of that is? I'm not trying to demean or discount what he's doing, but it's
almost like if you only have to play half of the floor. Right. If you put a talent like James Harden into that position, he's going to give you what he's giving you now. So it's not, he definitely had D'Antoni, and we're calling him D'Antoni because he doesn't deserve the D in his name. D'Antoni has had some people over the years where his system definitely made them look like better players. But in this case, like, he has an uber talented player to put into that position. And it's just making him look even better, because James Harden is going out on a nightly basis getting double figure assists now. And we didn't think he was interested in doing anything but shooting. He led the Rockets to a 2-1
week. He was a good passer.
No, he was always a good passer, but I'm talking about the numbers. You know, the numbers weren't there like that. Listen to these assist numbers from this week. In the three games this week, he scored 32 points and 15 assists, followed by 24 points and 15 assists and 12 rebounds, had a triple-double. And then through 9 games this season, he's averaging 30 points, 13 assists, and 8 rebounds. Like, come on. It's like James Harden and and Russell Westbrook are doing their best Oscar Robertson impersonation so far this season. Like, they're a blip off of a triple-double average. Like, come on. And it's not the assists.
I want to like dude, man. I want to like dude, man, but I can't do it, man.
I like him as a player. I definitely like him as a player, but he is, you know, like he's a part of the prideless bunch. Like, I don't want anybody to bust my ass just strictly out of pride. So if I got to D you up just so I won't get embarrassed, I'm going to D you up so I won't get embarrassed. It's crazy.
No, he doesn't care. He doesn't care. He doesn't care.
Play D for what? Question for you. Greg Oden was recently in an interview, and the interviewer asked him how he would be remembered, you know, how he'd go down in NBA lore. And he said, well, he thinks he'll go down in NBA history as the biggest bust in league history. Do you agree with Greg Oden in that regard?
No, I don't. I don't. And I want to just comment that interview, like, that interview made me sad. Like,
it was kind of sad. It was kind of sad.
Because the way he was answering the questions was like, so are you a failure? Yeah, pretty much. I'm a failure. I failed at life. Nothing I do well.
Yeah, because the thing is, he's like back at Ohio State now. And the way he's talking about why he's back, it doesn't sound like this was a plan had his career turned out the way it was supposed to turn out. He's back there now because he's looking for something to fall back on. And that's sad. Like, a lot of these NBA players go back just to go back because they promised their mom or they just want to further their education. He's going back because he basically has to. He's like, yo, I'm looking for something to fall back on. I'm going to need a job in a couple of years. So, it was a sad interview, man.
Yo, it was sad because you could see through his attitude, like, if you listen to his voice on the surface, he was like chipper. And trying to sell you and make you believe that he's cool with it all. But his answer and his responses made you feel like dude might go at some point in his life and get the razors and put them to the wrist. Like, that's what I got out of that interview. I don't know if you got that, but I felt like he was depressed and trying to sell us that he's content. I don't think, because his answers were like, you know, I'm content with it. I mean, what else can I be content with it? I would change it if I could, but I can't. I can't change it. It just is what it is. I'm okay with it. I was like,
but
he's hurt.
I don't believe his sentiments, though, B, because I don't think you could be a bust because of career-ending injuries, basically setting in from the start of your career. He came in the league in 2009.
Kevin Durant agrees with you.
Yeah, he from 2008 to 2014, this man only played in 105 NBA games. He only played in two seasons with Portland, the team that drafted him. He only played in 82 games, averaged 22 minutes for them. But in the let's say his second year in Portland, where he played, his rookie year, he played in 61 games, averaged like 9-7. In 21 minutes, 21 and a half minutes a game. His second year in the league, he played 21 games, averaged 23.9 minutes a game, averaged 11 points and 8.5 rebounds per game. So when he was actually on the floor, he was effective.
That wasn't a bust.
He was effective when he was on the floor, and every time he stepped on the floor, he was playing with broken wheels. So to be out there broken – and you can still go out there for as long as you can
and
hold
get
11 up
and 8.
And get 11
and get
8.
Get 11 and 8.
Almost 11 and 9. Like, dude, I mean, if you got an opportunity, you would, you know, I don't know if you would have turned out to be the surefire, you know, can't miss prospect that he was touted to be. But and by no means would I call him the biggest bust in NBA history, because for me to be a bust, you would have had to actually have a career and you just sucked during your career.
Michael,
and I don't think that's
Michael Beasley, and I'm not calling Michael Beasley. I'm actually not calling Michael Beasley a bust. Maybe I should.
But he might be.
He's way closer to he's way closer to a bust than Greg Oden, because Michael Beasley has no injuries. There's no logical reason that he is what he is, because even when he's on the court, when he's in an NBA game and given free reign, he can give you 25. I don't know why he can't get on the court.
Because he's a head case who's not going to do anything but try to give you 25. Beasley is so talented and was so highly touted, there's no way he should be, like, taking time during his career and spending time in the Chinese league. Not because he wanted to, because he had to. Like, you shouldn't be that, because you should be an NBA superstar. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, I think I would have to consider him a bust. I'm not saying that, you know, Michael Beasley's the biggest bust in NBA history, but I would definitely have to consider him one. But Greg Oden was never given an opportunity by his body. So his body might be a bust, but him as a basketball player, I'm not going to call that man a bust.
And I hope that he finds peace and happiness.
I hope that he finds
a job. I don't think he's peaceful. I don't think he has a job. He gets water and he rebounds. I don't think
they probably do that for free.
They give him a couple of dollars. Give him a book stipend. I don't think he's happy, and I don't think he's peaceful. I think he's putting on a mask, and that makes me even more, you know, more sad. I don't go with him being the biggest bust. You got 11-8, man. When you were healthy, that ain't great. But Adonio Poyle, the African, was averaging 4-2 and got $50 million for it. So, yo, you all right? All right.
So there were some rumors this past week of Klay Thompson possibly being dealt to the Boston Celtics, and the rumors basically were started by Brian Scalabrine, who actually. He's a former Warriors assistant coach, and of course, you know, he's a former Boston Celtic. He has a show. Is it his show? I'm not sure if it's his show. I think it might be his show on Sirius XM Radio on Monday morning. I don't know if he was on the show or if he just has a show, but Scalabrine basically told people that he knew that the Warriors were shopping him and a deal to Boston might be in place. So the Warriors GM, Bob Myers, came out and said, you know, we're not trading Klay. And I don't know where the rumors came from, but since the rumors were out there, and I know in the War Room Sports Game Time group on GroupMe, people were throwing out scenarios for whatever team they were rooting for. Some Sixers fans in there trying to make sense of a trade to get Klay in Philly for a couple of those young, valuable pieces that the Sixers have acquired. Let's go down fantasy road for a minute. Do you think that the Warriors could possibly benefit from a trade? Because everybody, you know, Tobias called in earlier, talked about how they're in trouble with no rim protectors and this and that. Do you think the Warriors could benefit from a Klay Thompson trade right now? Or do you think if Klay leaves, then they're just not winning any NBA titles? What's your thoughts?
No, I think it depends on what Klay is traded for. The further into the season I get, the more I begin to agree with Tobias's sentiment, not from the standpoint of regular season or even playoffs, but the one thing that we know that LeBron James can do on his own, with help, with cheating from the refs, with calls from David Stern and Adam Silver, yo, LeBron James is going to get to the cup. He's going to get to the rack. And if there's nobody there to meet him, that could be a long and arduous series for the Warriors to have to deal with that, because then you are almost forced to outscore all the time, and they're a jump-shooting team. And so I think while they could still win it, I think their chances are improved by improving defensively. And now with having Durant, I don't think you need Durant, Klay, and Steph. I think it's overkill. I think Klay is a – I was about to say Hall of Fame. What's wrong with me? I think Klay is an all-star. He's an all-star level two guard, kind of fringe, you know, not every all-star game, but he can make all-star teams. He's a quality wing. I think you trade him and you try and really bring back someone who can give you a little bit of interior scoring, but more importantly, some rim protection, some defense. And I don't know who that person is because they had two of them. Well, they had one that could score and one that could protect the rim, and then they had one that was just a failure on offense, but he could protect the rim. You got to get some rim protectors. So that's the trade that I would like to see the Warriors make. It's okay to get rid of Clay, but you have to get something in return that improves your defense. And I think all of that shooting on the perimeter is kind of diminishing returns. It's diminishing returns. There's only one ball to shoot, so I don't mind them getting rid of Clay if it's going to bring them back something that they need.
No doubt. Yeah, I agree with that. I believe the situation, it like you said, it all depends on who they would get back. I'm sure there could be benefits to trading Klay Thompson if you get the right bounty in return. So I definitely agree with you on that, B. Austin. One more thing I want to ask you about, and I wish we had Jimmy on to talk about this, because I know that he takes a different position than me, and knowing you, I'm pretty sure he would take a different position than you on this as well. And I don't want to make this just about LeBron, but LeBron is the biggest star in sports, you know, maybe sports, not just basketball, but in American sports right now. So last night against the Pacers on the road, LeBron took a day off for rest, no injuries or nothing like that, just a rest. So, like, what do you think about this new trend in the NBA where star players are taking days off to rest? Like, what are your thoughts on that?
No, minimal respect for the game. They're not thinking of it from the perspective of, you know, my fans come to see me.
Right.
And they deserve.
No matter what city you're in. Like,
to see me.
I heard somebody say today, well, LeBron doesn't owe anything to the fans of Indiana, just the fans of Cleveland. Well, that's BS. First of all, because of the way that the NBA markets the game, like, these superstars have.
He's bigger
than the game. You know what I'm saying? Like, people are buying tickets to see you. A lot of these arenas would be half empty on a normal night. When you come to town, there's going to be a sellout. And to just say that, I mean, we've all been in arenas. If LeBron James comes to the arena, do you know how many Cleveland Cavalier fans or bandwagon fans or, you know, real fans or just transplants? It's going to be a lot of LeBron James jerseys in the crowd. And the same with, you know, a bunch of other players probably to a lower extent, a lot of other superstars who travel around the league. So to just dismiss it and say he doesn't owe anything to the fans of the Pacers, I guarantee you that there was a great percentage of Cavs fans, especially LeBron James fans in that crowd. So, I can't bang with it, man. Mustification of our league.
I'm only cool with the rest thing if you're dealing with a player who has reached an age where it's absolutely necessary, where the reality in that situation is that player probably is playing too big a role on your team and maybe should consider a new line of employment pretty quickly. But I can understand, you know, there have been throughout the history of the league guys where their skill set, if not their athleticism, is so great that it's worth having them on the roster, even starting them, and then there's certain situations where their body just can't go on a back-to-back-to-back. You know what I'm saying? And they're right. 14, 15, 16, 17 years in, but you can't. But usually those guys aren't a guy. That's not a guy that people are just coming to see them alone. You know, but, right. I think it's really corny. I think that it is just what you said. It's the wussification of the league. I saw Larry Bird play with no back.
Yo,
back.
But, But my bigger problem than what they're even doing in the league now is how so many people from our generation are just conforming to, you know, everything that they do to wussify sports these days. Like, it's crazy because, you know, the guys that I was arguing and debating this with are guys from our generation. And shout out to Jimmy for this, because he did make a great point about the whole thing. He was like, the pressure comes from us as fans. And I'm just saying us because I'm just putting all fans in one bubble, because it's definitely not me, because I'm definitely not of the mindset that a player can't be an all-time great if he doesn't win a championship or a bunch of championships, this and that. But the pressure to win championships are so great for people's legacies now, it's forcing people to do all of this stuff that we consider soft. It's forcing you to go team up with people that you should be competing against. It's forcing people to sit out and take rests. Shout out to Popovich for starting this. But you know, people are resting now because they're looking towards the playoffs. I think if this is going to be an issue in the league, then you subtract games from the regular seasons, because this is going to hurt fans. I was giving examples the other day, like what it costs to go to a sporting event these days. Let's just break it down. My son's two favorite players, Steph Curry and LeBron James. So let's say, you know, for argument's sake, let's say we live in Indiana. First of all, ticket prices are exorbitant everywhere now. But they, you know, teams get away with jacking prices up a little bit, especially when there's a mega star in town. So let's say, you know, let's say my son wanted to go see one of his favorite players. And matter of fact, we don't even have to go to Indiana. Like, if they come to Washington, we go to see LeBron James in Washington. And I've traveled to see this dude, you know, pre-rest days. So I'm glad he wasn't doing that then. But just imagine, B, I take my son to a game. You already know. I mean, we don't generally pay to get in Wizards games, but if we were going to pay and we had to take our sons and we want respectable seats in the lower bowl, we're going to pay at least $100 per ticket. So that's $200 right there for tickets. Parking downtown D.C. somewhere could cost you up to $40 if you want to get anywhere close to the arena. So that's $40 for parking. That's $200 for tickets. A meal for two people in the arena is going to cost you $40 to $50. Well, he's a little dude. He's five. I'm going on now. It's going to cost us probably $50 to get a meal. It's going to cost you $30 for that souvenir that he's going to whine and bitch about. You know what I'm saying? So you are spending a nice little bag to go see these dudes, and then you get to the arena, and he's not even probably – hadn't even made the trip, or he's in the hotel, or he's sitting on the bench in street clothes, and you did all of that so your son could come see his favorite player. Like, I would have a major problem with that. And that's why I have a major problem with anybody who defends this crap. Because if you're going to do that, last point, if you're going to do that, then the NBA either has to subtract games or they have to change the way they promote their game, because they don't promote teams. They promote superstars. And they promote faces and individuals. So you can't do that. And shout out to Phil Maddox from Tissue and the Tape. And he said half the time, the actual photos of these superstar players are on the tickets that you buy. So I'm going to buy a ticket for my son that costs $100 with LeBron's picture on it. And we're going to go to the game. And this dude's not even playing.
Man, and then what they're going to do is they're going to give James Jones minutes. And because you don't like James Jones, you're going to say something to James Jones. James Jones, at times in his life, has thought he was tough. So then you're going to storm the court because you're not going to let James Jones, of all people, disrespect you in front of your son. And then you're going to have to, you know, and then that's going to cost you $2,000.
And then you're going to be ejected from,
catchy charge, and it's
and
all
you're
going to
be banned from every NBA arena from now on. So now you can't take your son, who's a burgeoning basketball fan, you can't ever take him to a game again because you're not allowed in the NBA arena, all because LeBron James
your son
didn't play that.
Your son saw you beat up James Jones. Like,
out of frustration because I had to watch James Jones. Like, are y'all giving me a partial refund for these tickets because I got to watch James Jones instead of LeBron James?
They're not even going to give you, like, Dante Jones. At least, you know, Dante Jones can leave the earth and jump. And you can say, look, he's jumping high. Like, James Jones doesn't do anything.
Jonte Jones would be good if it was a hockey game. He's going to start a fight, but that ain't what I came to see.
Yeah.
So, I don't bang with it, and I'm ashamed of all my fellow generation mates who are trying to justify this stuff.
Whenever you look at the current generation and you have criticisms for the kids, it's always the generation before that caused the situation that created the kids. So it's always going to be
all
the previous generation.
Fickle fans who,
they saw.
I mean, Michael, let's call a spade a spade. It's Michael Jordan's fault. You know, because everybody, Michael Jordan has, stands for fans, which we are of that group. But at the same time, what we do, we know how to be objective about things. Like, Bill Russell was on a team where he won 11 championships before Michael Jordan ever showed up into the league. But you didn't hear about, I swear, Bill Russell didn't become, to at least our generation, didn't become this, top of the Mount Rushmore type dude until after Mike, because you realized there was somebody with more championships. It just wasn't that important until Mike ran off six. It really wasn't.
Could it have been?
So now it's the only thing for some fans that are here. And these players feel the pressure. So they turn into wusses because they have to do anything and everything in their power to cater to what the fans think their legacy should be and how it should be played out. F-O-H. Yo, hurry up, because we got to get to some stuff. And we're low on time.
Couldn't it have been that, Wilt peed on his goggles every time he saw him on the crowd?
But that didn't matter, because he won the chips and Wilt didn't. But anyway, our stat of the week is basketball related as well. And hold up, I got to find it real quick. I got to pull it up. Our stat of the week is a shout out to Michael Jordan. Speaking of Michael Jordan, on yesterday's date, 20 years ago, the Monstars blew a 66-18 halftime lead to Michael Jordan and the Toon Squad. So we want to say happy anniversary to that magnificent comeback, probably the greatest comeback in sports history. No disrespect to you, Frank Reich, and the Buffalo Bills, but 66-18 at halftime, and then Michael and Bugs and Babs and all them people came back to win. Man, that's a stat for your A. That's a stat for your A. All right, so real quick, Babs had more game than all of them, for real, for real.
That's a game.
All right, so real quick, check out our website, worldroomsports.com. If you want to call in and speak with us about, we're about to talk about the Dallas Cowboys real quick. So if you got anything to say about the Dallas Cowboys, call us on the Digital Screen Tech Hotline. That number is 323-410-0012. Press one when prompted. If you're already listening from your phone, just press one if you want to talk. So, you guys tired of reading the same old sports books with tired old sports lists, rankings, imaginary starting lineups, etc.? Well, be sure to pick up your copy of Sports. Smart People Only Read the Sports by Jimmy Williams of the War Room. Shout out to the Blueprint. This is the Illmatic of sports books, and its mixture of sports and hip-hop culture will keep you mesmerized from beginning to end. Just go to sportsthebook.com or get your copy from our website at warroomsports.com. But whatever you do and wherever you end up getting your copy, just make sure that you do not miss this movement. All right, the big news of the week, man, is definitely coming from the Dallas Cowboys camp. Tony Romo he held a press conference the other day and gave what seemed like a presidential concession speech. Like, Tony Romo had to make a concession speech a few days after Hillary Clinton had to make a concession speech, and he's basically conceded the quarterback position to Dak Prescott. Not that he had a choice, because after all the bravado by Jerry Jones throughout this whole ordeal in the past couple of weeks, when he realized his team was about to be 6-1, then 7-1, then 8-1, he backed down off of all that bravado. And now we're in a situation where Dak Prescott is the quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys, but I guess they gave Tony a chance to kind of save face and make it look like it was a decision that he's totally cool with. But what I do, you know, I don't generally get into the who's classy and who's not in sports, but I do think Tony Romo handled this with a lot of class because at some point he had to sit back and realize, even though this is very hard for him because injuries have derailed his chances of playing with the best Dallas Cowboys team that he's ever had, and he even says that in his speech, he has to realize, look, this is kind of how you got your job. This is how Tom Brady got his job. Like, things happen. And when a team is 8-1, you have to, cliche, quote-unquote, ride the hot hand. You have to do what you have to do. So what did you think of his overall speech? What do you think of the situation? What do you think of them going forward? Because we don't want – well, we're fans of another team. Objectively, we don't want – I'm speaking for sports fans in general, but – as Eagles fans, no, that's different. But, you know, we don't want this Dak thing to end up being a Robert Griffin III type thing and everybody's excited. They go and deal Tony or something like that, and then next year Dak comes back into some Shaq. But what are your thoughts on Tony Romo's press conference and his quote-unquote concession speech?
Man, if we don't get the hell out of here talking about the first of all, I'm sick of it being, you know, the team that makes America hate again. I mean, you're a Dallas Cowboys star and a former starter, so this is big news. And you know, okay, the team is 8-1.
All right, you hating now? How is it not big news? I mean,
I'm gonna give it 100. If I'm going completely objective, Tony Romo,
this is big news, though.
Probably one of my favorite quarterbacks ever.
That's why I think it's big news because counter. Yeah. You know, on the contrary to the bad rap and the false narrative that just people who hate the Dallas Cowboys give to Tony Romo, like, Tony Romo is a very good NFL quarterback. You know what I'm saying? And especially on this team, because until this year, this team couldn't win games without Tony Romo, no matter what people said negatively about him. So it's a very big and interesting story that the first time this team gets on the road without him, he loses his gig. That is a huge story, man.
Yeah, it is. It is. I thought I don't think he had any other choice but to take this approach because any other choice would have put him in a bad light with Jarrell. And you got to remember, Tony Romo is making about $21 million this year, whether he's playing or not. So, you know, for him, he don't want to mess his money up. So, you know, I agree with you with bad light. Classy.
I don't necessarily agree that bad light would be from Gerardo.
From you think it's from the fan base?
I mean, I think it's a fan base thing. It's a looking forward thing, just in case he ever wants to join another team. They'll know. At least they think they have an ultimate team player. So I think he just had to keep, you know, in good graces. Plus, this is football. Dak Prescott is always one play away from having his ass, you know, up in the hospital or back on the bench somewhere. So Tony does have to stay in good graces. So if he does get that job back, everybody will be behind him because they view him as being behind, you know, Dak in the situation.
Do we want to talk X's and O's in this situation? Because if we want to talk X's and O's, you know, I'm very impressed with the O-line. I'm very impressed with their defense. I'm very impressed with Ezekiel Elliott. Ezekiel Elliott makes me angry because being an Eagles fan, I believe that he is the real deal. Even though he has that Emmitt Smith type of O-line, it's the things he does 4 yards down the field. Like, he's not just running through holes and then, oh, I'm here like DeMarco Murray.
Like, dude has to wiggle with him. He's got power.
In the last couple of weeks, though, if you look at those, and I'm not discrediting him because I think he's the real deal as well. But I think when you were giving out your very impressed, you know, status, I think, you know, that you should have reserved the very impressed for the offensive line. If you watch that Steelers game, on the winning touchdown, not a pinky scratched that man's jersey.
They
just ran in a straight line.
They didn't touch
him. On that 83-yard screen pass, 83-yard screen pass, not a pinky touched that man's jersey. So, you know, I might leave the very – I might leave the – yeah, I'm impressed with Zeke. I'm very impressed with Zeke. But I'm very impressed with the Dallas O-line because as much as you don't want to believe it's as good as it is, it is.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
They're that good.
They're human. They get penalties. They hold. They jump. You know, false start just like everybody
but
else.
They beat you up and down the field like they're your pop. I'm not that impressed with that. Because in this league, especially in today's game, at some point you expect the starter of your football team to have to throw the ball in order for you to win. And he hasn't had to throw the ball on many occasions for them to win. It's not a situation where they're down two touchdowns on a regular basis or down three touchdowns, and everyone in the stadium knows that they got to throw the football. I don't see that happening consistently, so I don't really know. I mean, he's done okay. He hasn't made a lot of mistakes. So I am impressed to an extent.
I can be halfway with you on that, but I definitely have seen improvement. They definitely, in the last couple of weeks, have opened it up a little bit and let him go down the field a little bit. He's utilizing his weapons. You have a guy in Michael Irvin where you could just throw the ball and he's going to go get it, whether it was a good or bad throw. But I don't know. There were moments in that Philly game where I'm thinking Dak might have a little bit of front runner in him because this is the only game where he was really pressed to the limit. And I do think if it weren't for the stupid decisions of the Eagles and their coaching staff, like they may have left that game with everybody thinking like, uh-oh, Dak might have a little bit of, you know, chink in the armor. Can I say that about him? Because he's not, you know, I don't know if we can even say that term anymore. He might have a little bit of imperfections in the armor, but the Eagles and their decisions kept giving him chances. And I did respect this in Dak that, okay, if you're going to keep giving me chances in a game where I'm pretty much stinking it up, I'm eventually going to burn you. So I give him props for, you know, keeping his head down in that storm. And then, you know, once the storm let up, he was still standing to do what he had to do. But I saw a little bit of front run in him. A little bit. If the Eagles were a team that kept their foot on your neck, which we know they're not, then I think some people might be questioning some things right now, and Tony might not have had to make that concession speech. But all in all, man, he said a lot of things. I think he kept it 100 in the speech because he let you know about the emotional roller coaster. You know, a lot of people. You wouldn't give them the benefit of the doubt to even say, like, man, it's you know, I love the team. I want us to be good, but it's hurting me to be sitting over here while this dude is playing this well and this team is winning like this. It hurts you to see them do that without you. But at the same time, you know, he once was best for the team. I thought it was a very well-written, very well-thought-out statement that he made, and you know, I give him a lot of props for doing something that's very difficult, even if the end game in that was to save face just in case something happened in the future, just in case a trade happens and you end up somewhere else, you know, you need the fans to be behind you, just in case something happens and you get back under center in Dallas, but just in case Jerry Jones, you know, did promise you that offensive assistance job when you retired. Whatever you had to do to keep people in your good graces, I think this did, because I haven't heard anybody outside of just straight up cynical people who hate the Cowboys and hate Romo say anything negative about, you know, the speech he made. It was mad dramatic. It was America's teamish. It was attention grabbing, you know, a little bit of attention whoring and dramatic. But, you know, I dug everything he said, man. I understood where he was in this whole situation, man. Because that's being put between a rock and a hard place, B. Like, imagine that. Like, you love your team, but, you know, you're used to being that dude on your team. So you have to sit out and somebody else is in your spot killing it. Like, you know, you want to hate a little bit, but at the same time, so that's a hard place to be in, man. Hard place to be in.
Well, they got to deal with Chief Sizzle and Doomerville this week, so we'll see how that, you know, how that lands.
And the funny thing about it is, I still wholeheartedly think that Tony Romo is the best quarterback on the Dallas Cowboys roster. It's just,
right.
It's, you know, we're just living with the cliche. You have to. A team 8-1, they haven't lost a game since week one. You cannot make a major change like that and go to somebody who you know can play, but, you know, rust is a thing. Chemistry is a thing. So you'd be foolish right now to change, you know, any of the major components of this team right now, especially a quarterback. So while I wholeheartedly believe that Tony Romo is still the best quarterback on their roster, I think this is a move that they had to make. Now, that's my objective sports analyst side. My Philly fan side says, I hope this blows up in their face. I hope Dak turns out to be a bum. And then when Tony comes back, I hope he breaks his back and his neck again. It's like, no, that's a little harsh. I'd never wish injury on anybody, but I'm saying.
I hope they trade Tony away, and I hope that Dak is everything that Norbit was for the D.C. professional football team.
You know what I hope for Tony? Since I could never root for him being an Eagles fan, but I've always respected him and thought he got a bad rap from narrative followers and people who didn't really know what they were talking about. I hope next year he gets traded to the Denver Broncos and wins the Super Bowl. I'm putting him on the Broncos because, you know, that's the only defense that's just ready for one move to be made on offense and they're ready to go. But knowing Tony after like three games, Tony would be, you know, on his back screaming.
After
you know
three games,
he'd
be in a
my
full
neck,
cast.
My back, my neck and my back. Ow.
So real quick before we get out of here, we mentioned it earlier. You said Ezekiel is the real deal, but all right, let's dig deep for 2 minutes. Actually, we probably got like one and a half. Like, how good do you think he is? Because he's leading the league in rushing. He has over 1,000 yards already. Do you think, and Eric Dickerson's rookie rushing record is in jeopardy. Do you think he's like best running back in the league right now, good? Or just learn how to take advantage of what he's running behind, good? Because I saw that improvement. Zeke in the first 2 weeks of the season was an impatient runner. He started getting some patience behind that offensive line. Oh, no.
I think he's talented enough to threaten that top echelon at some point in his career, probably sooner than later. But right now, see, for me, when you talk about the top three in any position, they are going to be dominant to different degrees, but they're going to be dominant on any team you put them on behind any line. I don't think Zeke would be dominant behind every line in the NFL. So, you know, for me, I think that he's definitely easily the best rookie back. And I think he's definitely cracking that top 10. But he's not, you know, he's not Le'Veon Bell level. I wouldn't even put him above. He's not better than Shady McCoy. Shady just can't stay healthy.
You know, there's a lot of Dallas fans right now listening, like, you crazy, you hating. But I agree with what you're saying. Definitely agree with
you. No, I think I see the talent. I see the talent. But if you take that talent and you put that behind, there are certain guys that are so dominant and so good that they would be able to dominate behind trash runs. And I don't think he's that explosive or that type of back yet. But it's there. It could be.
Well, we got to roll, man, so we'll get back. We'll talk about it some more. But we'd like to thank all the good folks out there for joining us again in the War Room. Shout out to everyone in the chat room on Facebook, Twitter, and all the callers who called in to chop it up with us. Tune in next week, live right here on demand on the WRS Podcast Network for more great sports and locker room talk. Shout out to President-elect. We'll recap week 11 of the NFL season and preview week 12, as well as NBA, college basketball, and a bunch of other sports talk. So until then, enjoy your week. Enjoy your weekend of football, basketball, hockey, or whatever it is that you like. And we'll see you right back here next time. Be sure to catch our conversations on Facebook and Twitter, as well as our blogs, webcasts, and network podcasts on WarRoomSports.com. And definitely join WRS Book Club on Facebook. Also, make sure you pick up Jimmy's book, Sports the Book, at sportsthebook.com or WarRoomSports.com. Until next time, everybody, don't accept mediocrity. Be steadfast in the war against ignorance. We'll see you chumps on top.
All the blueprint.
Yo,
every Thursday, 6 to 8, they do this. Shout out to Dez, PJ, B-Austin, Doc Bay on replay. WarRoomSports.com. Get that mobile app. If not, dial.
Call it
323-14-0012. They've been going and you sensitive, then oh well.
Yeah.
Physical podcast, let's talk sports. Showtime like magic in the block push. Listen live, push one to join in. Rip your team or listen for your enjoyment. Hip hop dollars, pit stop and knowledge. Should be in sports credits, I ain't talking college. Five guys, no beef though. Corporate secret, but the streets know. Belafonte, I got a G flow. KC, royalty, I'm in beast mode. 2 hours, get your game up. Who's the best in sports cast? You better name us. War Room Sports.
All three of y'all, stop playing with my name.
War Room Sports. www.warroomsports.com. What? Ain't no more to it.
When you don't go to Geico.com, car insurance can be confusing. Like Swedish techno confusing.
Bark, bark, meow, meow. Dance with me, purple cow. Bark, bark, meow, meow. Ooh, you lovely cow.
Geico makes it easy. With 24/7 access, all you have to do is go to geico.com and you could save money on car insurance. It just makes sense. Unlike, you know.
Dance with me, purple cow. I like your moves.
Are you ready to lose those love handles? Do you work hard to stay in shape and eat healthy, yet you can't get rid of stubborn fat? Now there's a clinically proven way to help you look slimmer without surgery or downtime. It's called Sculpture. Sculpture's innovative procedure destroys fat in just 25 minutes with visible results as quickly as 6 weeks. Sculpture sounds amazing, right? Check it out for yourself by clicking on the banner or go to goodbyefat.com.